Good afternoon. I'm going to talk about the recent advances of GNSS multipath reflectometry. First, I would like to acknowledge my co-authors, Tony and Olivier from University of Luxembourg, Felipe from University of Rio Grande do Sul, and Simon from National Oceanography Center of UK. In this presentation, I will talk about the SNR-based GNSS multipath reflectometry, and then using forward and inverse modeling of multipath reflectometry, I will show some results of snow depth, soil moisture, and sea level retrievals, and then I will close my presentation by the conclusions. But what's GNSS multipath reflectometry? In GNSS multipath reflectometry, the main observable is SNR observation. That can be modeled as a trend and detrended SNR fringes. They are a function of direct interferometric and noise powers and interferometric phase. The interferometric phase is the most important function for us or observable for multipath reflectometry. That is a function of geometric and compositional phase contribution and antenna phase contribution. But as the physical parameters of the GNSS multipath reflectometry are not error-free, we rewrite the SNR observable by adding a set of biases to estimate the correction for each bias. So the SNR observation can be modeled as a set of, again, direct noise and interferometric powers and a set of biases that can be used to estimate geophysical parameters. We developed a software to study the impact of signal and antennas on the GPS observables. On the top panel, we see the fringe visibility of the GPS L2PY and GLONASS R2P over elevation angle when the antenna height is changing from 1 to 100 meter. As we expected, when the antenna height is increasing, the fringe visibility decreases because that's a function of the chipping rate of the signals. In the bottom panel, we see the impact of the antennas on the received fringe visibilities. For example, on the GPS L2CL, we have four different antennas, and the green one is for the geodetic Trimble antenna, so it has the best performance in terms of multipath intake, while the Trimble choke ring antenna, the black one, has the best performance in terms of positioning to suppress the multipath. So in this simulator, we can estimate, we have the gain pattern of most of the antennas, and it can be used to be used for different applications. Then we use the GPS GNSS station in French Alps to estimate snow depths. First, we wanted to compare the SNR observables. The top panel shows the SNR, all the received GPS observation, and the bottom shows the GLONASS observable. It's very clear that the GLONASS SNR observable are less noisy and more comparable with each other, while for the GPS, the L2PY is noisier than the rest. And then we use the SNR observable to model the specular distances around the GPS antenna. Again, the top shows the result from the GPS, and the bottom panel shows the result from the GLONASS. As the inclination angle of the GLONASS is higher, the hole in north direction for this station is smaller compared to that one from the GPS. It's also very clear that the retrieval have to be treated in the homogeneous way. So SNR observations have to be clustered based on track repeatability to treat them as homogeneous conditions. So we model the GPS and GLONASS observable to estimate the first Fresnel zones around each GNSS antenna. And then we cluster them based on the azimuthal angle and ascending or descending status of the satellite tracks. It's very clear in the top panel when we do that, as the ground repeatability of the GPS is every one sidereal day, we have less cluster than that of the GLONASS, because GLONASS is repeating every 8 sidereal days. So we have to recluster them again based on just azimuth angle. We also found that the SNR observations are highly dependent on the equipment. So whenever we change the antenna, receiver, and even firmware upgrade, we have to add another constraint when we want to cluster the track. So we cluster all the observations based on this information, and then we estimate snow depth. This station shows the estimated snow depth in 2012 for whole the one water year. The red one, it shows the GPS estimates, and the green one is the in-situ snow depths close to the station. The correlation is better than 99%, and the RMS error is less than 2 centimeters. The blue one shows the snow tail, which is about 60 meter altitude difference with the GPS station, but it shows the same trend as that of GPS. Then we started to combine the solutions to have a multi-GNSS snow depth retrievals. The advantage of combining this observation is providing more observable. It's important when we want to have the sub-daily estimates, because we would need to have enough satellite tracks per hour to have the sub-daily retrievals. On the other hand, for those sites that we have azimuthally constrained, for example, because of the trees, the combination is very important to provide more observables. Here, we show on the top panel the number of satellite tracks based on azimuth angle for GPS L2CL, and the last one, the red one, is the multi-GNSS that provides the daily satellite tracks for us to estimate the snow depths. Then we tried different methods to combine the estimates to have the multi-GNSS, and we came up with an optimal way to use the variance factors to estimate the snow depths. We also combined all the GPS solutions, as some of the stations still don't receive GLONASS or other constellation signals. So the first panel, the green one, shows the GPS-only combined solution where the formal error is about 2 centimeters. The blue one is the GLONASS-only combined solution using all the signals from the GLONASS, and the formal error is 1.7 centimeters. And the red one, the third panel, is the multi-GNSS combining all the GPS and GLONASS signals, and we reach to 1.3 centimeters of formal error using all the signals. And the last panel shows the errors errors using all these combinations. It's very clear that combining all the signals to have the multi-GNSS helps to improve the precision and accuracy of the GPS signal. In another contribution, we started to use this method to estimate soil moisture. We developed a method to use a quadratic mode to estimate phase shift that can be converted to soil moisture. These are the results for two different stations, one in the United States and another one in South Africa. For the station in the South Africa, we used the GS1C signal, and for the station in the US, we use GS2X signal to estimate the soil moisture. If we just use the linear form to estimate soil moisture, we will have what we see here in red, and the blue one shows the result that when we use the quadratic model to estimate the interferometric phase that can be converted to soil moisture. As we can see, here are the results for GS1C for the station in South Africa, and the RMS error is better than what's needed for the satellite validation purposes. For the satellite validation purposes like SMAP, they need 0.04 cubic meter per cubic meter, and using this quadratic model, we reached to 0.036 for L1, and when we use other signals, for example, when we use just GLONASS, it's much better because SNR observation of GLONASS, as I explained in the previous slide, is less noisier than that of GPS, and it fulfilled the requirement of the satellite validation purposes. In the next contribution, we started to use GNSS to estimate tide gauge. as the tide gauge to estimate sea level. Here is the station in Australia. We developed a model to have the vertical velocity of the reflector height to estimate the sea level. As you can see, there are two models when we don't include the vertical velocity as basic, and the EDM when we include the vertical velocity estimates to correct the sea level corrections. The RMS error is better than 6.37 centimeter when we use the modified version, and the slope deviation between tide gauge record and GNSS retrieval is better than 3 centimeter per meter. While for the basic model is a bit better than 15 centimeter, the RMS error, and the slope deviation is 26 centimeter per meter. So using this station, although the tidal ranges are not that high in this station, we see that it's very important to implement the vertical velocity and correct the estimate interferometric phase estimates. In another station we use in the UK, which has the larger high tides with about 5 meters, and the correlation is between the tracked tide gauge and estimated GPS is 0.99, and the RMS is better than 10 centimeters, while again the slope deviation is not statistically significant. We use another station on top of the lighthouse in the Germany to estimate sea level. Of course, for this station it's complicated because the antenna height above the sea level is higher, and we suffer from the chipping rate of the signal, so the results are noisier. But again, the correlation is better than 98, and the RMS error is better than 9 centimeters, and the slope deviation, again, is not statistically significant. After proving these methods using different GNSS stations around the world, we wanted to try to see if there is a bias between different signals when we want to estimate sea level. So we used a station in Africa and another one in Australia to test the signal consistency of retrieval. So as you can see, there is no bias between all the 5 signals that are received in these two GNSS stations to estimate sea level. So we don't need to care about the biases between the signals when we use the developed method to estimate sea level. After estimating sea level around the world, we decided to use the station to estimate sea level in Greenland and Antarctica. So this is the station in Antarctica, and the situation there is a bit more complicated because stations are further from the sea, so we have to modify our method to estimate the sea level, and then we estimate the sea level in Antarctica. As you can see, we estimate the tidal parameters and the agreement between tidal parameter using tide gauge and estimated GPS is better than 1 centimeter for all the constituents in this station. It's very important also for this station to correct the estimated height for the tropospheric delay. So for the stations in Greenland and Antarctica, we correct them first for the refraction delay, and then we estimate the sea level in those stations. And then these are the other two stations in Greenland and Antarctica, far from the sea, that we could estimate the sea level in these two stations. This is the result for 2007. The tides are very clear in those stations, and they can be used to estimate sea level in those parts of the world. As it's very important, we don't have enough tide gauge sensor there because of the ice movements. Whenever we have tide gauge record, there are gaps because they stop recording. But if we use our GPS to estimate tide gauge, there is no gap. For example, in this period, we have to estimate the tide gauge. So it can be used to, this method can be used to estimate tide gauge or sea level in different parts of the world. This slide, I come to the conclusion, we found that we can estimate the snow depth better than in centimeter level accuracy, and then we found that the GPS signals, especially the legacy one, are noisy, and we have to filter and pre-process the data before running the inversion to estimate the geophysical parameter. Then as we use the FDMA signal of GLONASS, our estimates didn't harm from the frequency division and didn't change. There were no bias or inter-signal bias for the snow depth estimation, while for the soil moisture, it's completely different, and there is inter-frequency, inter-system, and inter-antenna biases when estimate. So when we want to estimate soil moisture, we have to use proper model for each antenna, proper model for the signal, and also for the system. It's not possible to use just one calibration curve to estimate, to convert all the estimates from the GPS to soil moisture. And for the sea level, we found a very high correlation between the GNSS retrieval sea level and the tide gauge records with a centimeter level error, and the multi-GNSS combination offers more precise retrieval for this kind of products. And by that, I finish my presentation, and thank for your attention.